What's the correct way to frame out the interior? I see on YouTube guys are bolting sill plates to the floating slab, no footer. Then they will nail the studs to the sill plates and the posts. And then John says, that can't be right. So what do you have to say about that?
Well, and in my humble opinion, you're doing it the hard way. And this kind of reminds me of the all steel buildings or the weld up buildings where you build a structural steel shell and then you have to build a house inside a steel shell by framing up stud walls and building from there. So you're doubling your effort. And I see, you know, people posting up pictures of post frame buildings with exterior wall girts where the girts are flat on the outside of the posts, which I will mention that in most cases structurally that does not meet the requirements of the building codes. And then they're doing exactly what you are talking about. They're framing up a stud wall in between the posts. You're using lumber and you're using a lot of effort that you don't have to do. It is so much easier just to use bookshelf girts between the posts. You only have to frame that wall one time. It is far stiffer from the outside against wind loads. It'll meet the deflection criteria to keep drywall from cracking on the inside. You create an insulation cavity. You didn't have to come back and do anything again. So I've built several buildings for myself with bookshelf girts like that, and it's a terrific design solution. And I've been building buildings that way for 40 years now, and so it's not something that I created. Somebody else did it before me, and it really is a very efficient system. Very great way to go and creates a wonderful insulation cavity. So don't make it harder than it has to be. So while we're talking about interior walls, we had some of this discussion earlier this afternoon, but we can carry it forward here. And a case in point is my own house. So I happen to live in a shop house. And it's a big gambrel building with prefabricated trusses and very few interior walls, albeit some. Now, trusses do change slightly as humidity increases and decreases. So in the wintertime, in our part of the country, humidity becomes very low, and those trusses tend to basically lift up off the walls. Well, the builder that we hired to build our place, when they built the interior stud walls, they nailed the trusses to the tops of those walls. And they drywallers later on came in, they run the drywall on the ceiling, run the walls up tight to it, tape that joint, all great and wonderful till the first winter comes, the trusses raise up, they crack all that drywall joint. So some solutions, and first of all, clear span trusses should not be affixed to interior walls to begin with. Simpson makes a great part that can be used to attach the top of those stud walls to the trusses and allows the trusses to still be able to move up and down. Okay, so what do you do with the joint there at the top of your wall? You run the ceilings first, you butt your drywall on the walls up to that, and you do not tape that joint. Instead, you use a crown molding at the top of the wall and you affix the crown molding to the trusses. So when the trusses shrink, when the humidity goes down and they raise up, the crown molding goes with it and there's no sheetrock joint to crack. Pretty darn slick. Well, we had solved this in my own house. However, my installer failed to listen to instructions and he attached the crown molding to the wall. So wintertime comes, trusses rise up, and you could stick your finger above the crown molding, between the crown molding and the ceiling. So he was back today finishing the job the way it should have been done the first time. And Nobody will ever be the wiser. Crown molding looks great. You solved a plethora of problems, and the job now is done the way it should have been done in the beginning. You know, it's one of those word to the wise things, and even where I have what most people look at as a fair amount of experience, when you hire somebody to do work behind you, you have to just be, unfortunately, looking over their shoulder all the time. And then this goes back to people that are looking for a turnkey contractor to, you know, come in and you know, do everything for them, and they're hoping that everything turns out right. Well, that's what it is. It's a hope, because chances are there are going to be things that weren't quite right in there, and you're only going to find out later on that they weren't. So it really takes a lot of hands-on supervision if you're not going to be driving the nails and the screws yourself. All comes down to an end. Really, if you want the job done right, you're safe.